Hello once again. In this video, I wanted to briefly discuss the shell model structure of the nucleus. So the shell model structure of the nucleus is somewhat similar in a sense to the atomic structure. So in the atomic structure, what you have is you have electrons revolving around the nucleus in fixed discrete energy levels. And these energy levels are organized in such a manner that they end up creating what is known as shells. So whenever you have complete shell structure, which corresponds to certain fixed atomic numbers, then you end up getting very stable electronic configurations of atoms. So basically these stable configurations correspond to what is known as inert gases or noble elements like helium, neon, argon, krypton, etc., etc. So basically whenever you have atomic structures which corresponds to certain numbers that lead to filling up of these shells of atomic energy levels, then they end up creating very stable electronic structures and they correspond to very stable chemical elements. A similar concept also exists in the case of nucleus. So we have nucleus which has numbers of neutrons and some numbers of protons, and whenever these numbers correspond to certain numbers which are known as magic numbers, then you end up getting extremely stable nuclear configurations. So the magic numbers are 2, 8, 20, 28, 50, 82, and 126. So whenever you have a nuclei which has number of neutrons which correspond to the magic number, or number of protons which correspond to the number, or both the number of neutrons and protons correspond to the magic number, in that case, that kind of a nucleus has extremely interesting properties. It is extremely stable. It has a large number of stable isotopes and isotones. And it seems to have a spherical charge distribution. So let's look at a few examples. When you look at the binding energy curve, then helium and oxygen seem to have sharp peaks at the binding energy curve. So helium has double magic numbers. Double magic numbers means if both the number of protons and number of neutrons correspond to a magic number, then that is known as a double magic number. So helium has two neutrons and two protons. So it is a double magic number. Helium has a sharp peak at the binding energy curve. Similarly, oxygen, which also has a double magic numbers, 8 protons and 8 neutrons, has a sharp peak in the binding energy curve. Next, we have calcium, which has also double magic numbers, which is 20 protons and 20 neutrons. And calcium is seen to have 6 stable isotopes. So isotopes are basically those nuclear species which have same number of protons but different number of neutrons. So calcium is seen to have 6 different stable isotopes. Same way you have tin, whose nucleus has 50 protons, it has 10 stable isotopes. Now, in the same way you have isotopes, you also have isotones. So isotones are those nuclear species which have the same number of neutrons but different number of protons. The largest group of stable isotones is found for neutron number corresponding to 82, followed by 50 and 20. Next is the case of the radioactive decay series. So radioactive decay series are these naturally occurring radioactive decay series in which a larger nuclei undergoes successive radioactive disintegrations and finally stops when a very stable nuclear species is reached. So out of the 4 radioactive decay series, 3 of these decay series ends with lead. So the uranium decay series, the thorium decay series, and the actinium decay series all stop at lead. Now lead has a number of protons 82 and number of neutrons 126, which also corresponds to a double magic numbers. There is another interesting property associated with magic numbers, which is known as electric quadruple moment. So quite simply put, electric quadruple moment gives us an idea about the nuclear charge distribution. Since nucleus contains protons and these protons are spatially distributed in space inside the nuclear volume, then nuclear quadruple moment or the electric quadruple moment tells us about the nuclear charge distribution, whether the charge distribution is symmetric or not. So if the nuclear quadruple moment is zero, it basically means that the charge distribution is spherically symmetric. So that means the nucleus is spherical in shape. If the nuclear quadruple moment is non-zero, it simply means that the nuclear shape is non-spherical. It has a deformed shape. And it is seen that the nuclear quadruple moments corresponding to these magic numbers are very, very less. In fact, the nuclear quadruple moments has minimas corresponding to the magic numbers. So as you can see, these magic numbers correspond to extremely stable and abundant nuclear species. But why do these magic numbers exist in the first place? Now, obviously, as I said in the beginning, possible explanation could be similar to that of the atomic theory. In the atomic theory, in the same way that you have shell structure where certain kind of filled shells correspond to stable chemical elements, maybe in the nuclear model also you have nuclear energy levels where there are filling up of shells and there are certain filled shell structures which correspond to extremely stable abundant nuclear configurations. However, the difference between nuclear model and the atomic model is that in the atomic model, you have a very precise potential well. So the potential well is basically given by the Coulombic potential, which has a very precise mathematical function. And you can solve the Schrodinger's equation for the case of that Coulombic potential, and then you can come up with the energy level structures. However, in the case of nucleus, the potential well is not that precise. In certain cases, the nuclear potential well can be approximated by a square well potential, as we did in the case of the Fermi model. In some cases, you can approximate it to a harmonic well potential well. And one can solve the Schrodinger's equation for the case of a square well potential and for the case of a harmonic oscillator and see whether or not the energy levels you get correspond to these magic numbers that we are discussing. In fact, when the Schrodinger's equation was solved for the case of these different kinds of nuclear potential wells, for infinite square well, for finite square well, for harmonic oscillator, the numbers that emerged did not seem to match the magic number. We require a more precise kind of a nuclear potential well. A more precise kind of a nuclear potential well is neither a square well nor it is a harmonic oscillator, but it is something that is in between. It looks somewhat like a square well but with rounded edges. A more precise function to describe this kind of a potential well is known as the Woods-Saxon potential. When the Schrodinger's equation was solved for this kind of a Woods-Saxon potential, then the numbers that emerged also did not seem to match the magic numbers. What was missing? A final solution was obtained when two scientists, Mayer and Jensen, introduced the idea of spin-orbit interaction. Now, what is the spin-orbit interaction? Let's go back to our atomic model. So, in the atomic model, you have electrons revolving around the nucleus. Now, electron is a charged particle. When the charged particle revolves around the nucleus, it has an orbital angular momentum. It also has a magnetic moment associated with its orbital motion. Now, electron is also spinning on its own axis. And because of its spinning on its own axis, it has a magnetic moment. So the electron has a magnetic moment due to its orbital motion. It also has a magnetic moment due to its spinning on its own axis. Both these two magnetic moments can interact with each other. In fact, when these two magnetic moments are in the same direction, it is seen that the energy of that kind of a system is higher, and when the magnetic moments are in opposite directions, the energy of that kind of a system is lower. This is known as spin-orbit coupling or spin-orbit interaction. A similar kind of spin-orbit interaction also exists in the case of neutrons and protons. Since neutrons and protons also have non-zero magnetic moments, they also have a spin because they are fermions and they also have a motion inside the nucleus. They also have spin-orbit interactions which leads to splitting of their energy levels. However, in the case of atomic theory, the splitting of energy levels leads to very minute differences in energy, but the splitting of energy levels in neutrons and protons is almost 20 times greater than the splitting of energy levels in the atomic theory. So in the case of neutrons and protons, the splitting of energy levels completely changes the structure of nuclear energy diagram. So when this kind of a spin-orbit interaction was taken into account, then it was seen that these new energy levels formed what is known as shells. And when you calculate the numbers of neutrons and protons present in these shells, then the numbers correspond to 2, 8, 20, 28, 50, 82, and 126, which are the magic numbers. So as you can see, you can explain the existence of these kind of a magic numbers if you solve the Schrodinger's equation for the case of a Woods-Saxon potential and also introduce the concept of spin-orbit interaction. So in a manner, the shell model is successful in explaining the magic numbers and why certain kinds of nuclear species are extremely stable and abundant. In addition, the shell model also explains the pairing effect that neutrons and protons Since they are fermions, whenever they are present in their energy levels, then they tend to pair up. And when they pair up, they basically cancel each other's spin angular momentum. So that is it for today. This is a very brief discussion on the shell model structure of the nucleus. See you in the next video.